great to be here, and I'm going to just tell stories about things that happened in my life that maybe help us. A couple observations. I've just really enjoyed how the Y Conference has moved from talking about portfolios to talking about this battery of skills that we all have. And I think what's happening before our eyes is where we point our skills, our design skills, as we call them. It's a really bad name, but the things we learn by being design trained are going in different directions. So I'm just going to talk about what where they've gone for me and how they've kind of led my life. It's not really about a career. It's not about commerce. It's just been because we think the way we do and we've trained ourselves to be aware of things. Oh, curious. Try to build that into my talk. Because we're curious, and in a way, if several people have talked about things when they were young, and now they're still doing them. Wonderful work from Uppercase, and I think Chris and Wayne. There's a lot about keeping our youthful elasticity of thinking alive that is really why we're a little different. And I think we have some things that other people long for, and we should really share them in a lot of different ways. So I'm already off topic and off of my... I want to leave some time for Q&A. So I'm going to go through seven different observations about my life. You're not going to see really any work here in particular, but more thinking. The first one is I'm really enamored by this idea of celebrating things that are imperfect. In fact, that slide's kind of imperfect. Get it? Yeah. I was taught to look for the perfection in things. We're taught that in design. We can justify the hell out of everything right now with all the great things that Rufus has showed us. Rufus, where are you in here?
Here.
Okay, man. I love you. I'm going to beat up on you a little bit, but I love you, okay? We can really spend a lot of our time getting things perfect. And there's the human genome, right? We kind of figured that thing out. Everybody's got an iPhone in their back pocket. They are almost identical to each other. We can reproduce things that are almost perfect on huge global scales. And it's kind of intoxicating, particularly if you live here. That means scalability. That means making more money. That means disruptive thinking, which is kind of a code word for take the financial stream away from him and put the trough over to me. I think one thing Corinna just said is just because we can do it, should we do it? And that's part of what I'm curious about. So celebrating imperfection, I realized that I was kind of maybe trying to get rid of the thing I should be saving. In other words, I had a pretty big life crash a couple, 3 years ago. There was death, divorce, famine, and locust all in the same month. And I realized that all the things I've been working for are perfection. I'm going to work butt hard my whole career so I can then enjoy myself. I'm going to get all the books lined up. I'm going to get my portfolio perfect. I'm going to win as many awards. And then I'm going to relax and enjoy myself. I'm 60 now. Don't buy that. It's a crock of shit. Don't delay gratification. And don't really strive for perfection. Did I say that? I did. But I think these old things, so I'm going to go through what I mean by this, and there's one particular story. It has to do with something I love, which you'll see Italy throughout my presentation because it's my mistress, and it's taught me a great deal, and I think it has a lot it can teach all of us. This is a 250 Ferrari Lusso owned by somebody in town I know, and he invites me with some other guys to smoke cigars and hang around his cars. No women there. And we'd been drinking very fine wine. I didn't bring any. And we're looking at a myriad of his cars. And I slouched down in a couch very similar to this. next to a big black guy who had been smoking cigars. And we sat down, and I put my arm out, and his name was Sean. And he gave me one. And by that I mean, you know, certain moments, things you never forget. I said to him, Sean, while we're looking at that car, I said, what is it about that car that just gets in my body that I love so much? I can't figure it out. And I'm kind of sloshed and didn't really expect much of an answer. Making buddy talk. And Sean says to me, well, I just got back from Germany, and my job, I run the software that takes the drawn line or the clay model and translate it into logarithms and algorithms that can be machined and produced. And Wayne knows all about this. He said, so I take the hand and make it machined. He says, but if you look at those two fenders right now, they're not even. They're made on an English wheel by hand. And I have a philosophy about this. It's my own, but I'll share it with you. I feel that the fact that they're uneven makes us, in some subliminal way, more attracted to it. And I thought, wow, this guy isn't as drunk as he seems. And he says, I'll even tell you a secret. In the software I use, very few people use it, but when I program these, before it goes to machining, I change some of the numerics of the algorithm just a little bit because I want the God force to be in the design. He gave me a jewel. That's kind of what I'm talking about, of just because we can make things perfect doesn't mean they're valuable. So I don't have an end to what I'm saying. I'm just bringing up things that have inspired me or made me think. So I'm not as quick to throw away the imperfection sometimes. I also think that other cultures, Latin, I learned a lot from Mexico, who seems to be happier than I've ever been, with much less than I've ever had. Travel. Curiosity through travel is a natural. I try to travel as much as I can. I lead kind of two lives. One is the home that I love and the community that supports me, and that's you guys in San Diego, which I think is a very interesting, sharing, communicative, egalitarian, creative world that we have. It's unlike other cities. But I have another world that I spend time in, and that's this place in Italy called Radicondoli. It's up in that mist there somewhere. And it's as a landscape that changes my world. When I'm there, I reset myself. Have you ever had someone come to San Diego begrudgingly to stay at your house, and you've had to take them around town and show them all the beautiful places? What happens to you? You end up realizing what a beautiful place this is because you see it through their eyes. So it's that little bit of a shift that we get used to. As a creative, curious person, I need to shake myself up, and I realized I needed to make a commitment, so I actually bought this little place there as a commitment that I knew I would continue to go. But this is the landscape I really love. This is two villages over. It's a junkyard owned by my good friend Mazi. And this guy has the coolest shit in the world. And it's out in the middle of nowhere. And he calls me l'architetto. He thinks I'm an architect. Doesn't care. I haven't changed. He loves that we saved him in World War II. I'm coasting on my dad's hard work. But what I do when I go there is I look and I photograph and I sketch. I don't do any professional graphic design branding work there. But I love kind of going through culturally those great people that have been before us. I think we have a fallacy, particularly instilled by Rufus, that we're somehow more capable, more talented, more potent than what's come before us. I don't agree. We may be more productive. We may be more accurate. I don't think we're necessarily better, particularly if we don't have the cultural underpinnings beneath what we do. If not, we're just restyling somebody else's style. I'm gonna have to pick this up or we'll be here till 7. So these are some of the things that I photographed just quickly with an iPhone. These are just things that are on products These are old books. With my friend Fabrizio Schippa, we've been restyling what I might do with those. I'm rebranding my firm from Miriello Grafica to Miriello Brand Expression as I focus more on strategy. So this is some of those papers reused in an old new way. I'm very interested in taking the old and moving into the new than I am in closing the door on the old, because I think we might as well throw out all the books. Why would we do that? That's a cool can of oil. Look at that. And every side and every weight of oil is a different design. These are head badges from different bicycles that I've collected. This is a balsa wood silk airplane. It's about this big, in a box, hidden underneath some. And now I'm working with a friend of mine to photograph these. This is a found watch. It's a beautiful sculpture if you stop and look at it. I don't know what I'm going to do with these, but they're work in progress. They're just part of an archive. So for me, I call it type trekking, or it humbles me also to see those who came before me, and I have great respect, and I think humility has a big place in what we do. This is another thing that's unique to our profession, critique. I went to school at Colorado State. Every Friday, we'd have to rally our chairs around the wall, and we taped up or pinned up all of our work. And we would sit there and talk about it. It's something we borrowed from Rob Quigley's profession, the architect, critique. It's sitting there and discussing verbally between mano a mano what we think of the idea. And I think that's really something unique about what we do. We learn to get outside ourselves. It's not about you, it's about your idea. And you have to defend it. And you maybe someone else, God forbid, might make it better. And that is this acceleration of your thinking. So we now work in a box. It's called a computer. And a way to get feedback, Rufus, is to post it online and have somebody from Kuala Lumpur tell you to change its color. It could be good, and I'm not smacking that kind of community building. But I think this give and take that we have between ourselves in our ability to think and critique is really a divine kind of process. It's about listening to someone else. It's about not... Then there's a point at which you need to defend your work, but in the beginning, it's really about accepting other people's ideas. So, whoops. Here's... To me, this is like quintessential... You know, not everyone agrees. And we get beaten up a lot. And we're in this odd place. I think it was Chris who talked about that picture of Conan about commerce and art trying to live together. That's where we are. We're not fine artists. We are salespeople. I hate to tell you. But we are at the beck and call of people who want to make money on our back. And unless you realize that's what you're doing, really should be in fine art. That doesn't mean you can't create beautiful things along the way, but that's actually slide number 7, so I'm going to keep going. But I love this, but this is the key point here is I like when I work with people and when I hire people, I used to be heavily seduced by the sexy portfolio. And there are people I look at their work and go, God, I go into the bathroom and think, God, I hope I can afford them. This is incredible. And then my first date dwindled to horrible disappointment as I realized there was no there. Usually it came with huge ego. What I really look for now is someone who can take and give critique. And that's a hard thing to find. But I can train design. I can't train mindset. So if I'm talking to you about your design and you're there protecting it, I have to go through you to talk to the design, and it's too labor intensive. But if it's the design and you and me, and you get to critique mine, I get to critique yours, wow, there's a really cool energy flow there. That's about ego. And ego is a subject for another conference. Hearing the yes in the no. Another way to say that is turning a negative into a positive. That's the business we're in. Corinna did that. Under Armour had a negative. She mined that story to find what the positive was. Some people call that spin, but if it's done really from the right place, it's about seeing possibility. But I think it's about learning to overlook the no, turning the dark to light. It's our skill to see. We see things. This is the Edwin Land is the man who invented this. I'm still enamored by that little machine can record an image and spit it out in your hand. I'm almost as amazed by that as I am by my iPhone. Well, Edwin Land said, I just love what he said about inventing. He said, "It's for me, it's quite simple. I envision what it is I want to see, and I just continually remove all the reasons I can't do it." What has that got to do with this picture? This was kind of my negative. Not this place. This is the town that my grandparents were born in the south of Italy. This is some of them. It's a tradition of the crafts. And my negative was in the mid-70s, I was given a plane ticket and free tuition from Colorado State to go here. No, excuse me, not here, to go to Florence, and I went down here. There ain't no college anywhere near this town. And the reason I bring this up as a negative to a positive is when I lived in Colorado in the 70s, being Italian was neutral to negative. I wasn't very proud of being Italian. I kind of wish I could lop the L-O-O off of my name. I would kept thinking, Muriel. Yeah, that's better. Then I went there, and what was kind of a neutral moved over to an extreme positive that changed me forever. That's an example. That got me to want to move there. This is a shot of my village, Radicondoli. And this gets to another positive from a negative. It has to do with San Diego. So every time I go to my village, they kind of think of me as the smart California marketing guy. And I think of them as brilliant in their own way, and they are. But we'll sit down and have wine, and every conversation we eventually get to the subject of how I could help their village be more aware, be seen, get more tourists, do more business, because Italy's struggling right now. And I will go and we'll talk and have great ideas, and I'll wake up in the next morning and forget them, and I'll leave and come back 6 months later and we have the conversation again. And then as recently as last September, we had the conversation again. And I kind of felt like a doctor that was billing for something that wasn't helping. You know, you've been those guys that they should have stopped. You shouldn't be going to them anymore. And I said, Giovanna, hold on. We don't need any more great ideas. We need execution. And I said, really, I'm not the person to execute these ideas. I just come up with them. No, I didn't say that. But I said, I don't have the time, nor do I have the manpower, but I have somebody who does. And I was thinking of Candace Lopez. All of you know Candace? Most of you? Who, leader of the design department at City College here in San Diego. I'd met Candace, I'll try to make this quicker, the night before, went there, and she was in the back of my mind. And I said, you know, I think Candace, with her cadre of students, could probably turn that energy force toward my village. They would get a project. My city would get all the value of their creative thinking, where they're trying to point it somewhere with hypothetical projects. Let's point it at something real. They get to work with a real designer, and they have a relationship with a community across the world. So this is a Skype session. That's my good friend Giovanna talking about her town. There's Candace, and we kicked this off about a month ago. And unknown, to be honest, the students, I cobbled some of their work in progress. Maybe some of you are here. But these are some of the work they're doing about Radicondoli. These are works in progress that I am just thrilled by. Is it a negative going to a positive? No, but it's our creative mind saying problem, solution. That's a highly creative act. And I'm thrilled about this. Candace is actually going to be
coming over to Radicondoli in May. My town is going to sponsor her, and we're going to whiteboard out more specifically what we may want to do for Radicondoli to help them increase the volume of people who see them and know them for what they are, not just just another Italian town. This is another piece. The ideas the kids had were great. I want to do an app. And I thought, wow, this town of 800 people, when I walk in and some tourist is going to be accessing this ancient medieval village with an app, it's so cool. It's this mix of old and new that I love. It helps them, it helps us. It's just generative. It's this vortex of ideas that go up. We do that. Working with what you got, this is another way of saying resourcefulness. To me, resourcefulness is applied curiosity. Back to Edwin Land, he had this, he said, you should be able to solve anything with the materials you have in your room. I think a lot of times we come up with reasons why we can't do stuff, because we don't have a this or have a that. I think this conference has been a great one to see what you can do and how you can point this energy of design in so many different ways. And I think that's why we're here. We need each other. We need the support of each other. All of us are confused. I'm confused. But to be confused in a group is helpful, because you realize you may not know where you're going today, but knowing that others are searching similarly and that collectively there is a path we're taking and you have someone else to talk about your ideas with out of the computer, I think helps us move forward and gives us confidence. Because when we're outside of our domain, we oftentimes look pretty unanchored, without an idea, without really, why am I following? I think of the Uppercase magazine and I think, wow, that's pretty cool that she could do that on the support. Where did she get the support? But there's another curiousness I want to talk about, and has to do with somebody, has to do with this, the tsunami in Japan in 2011. We all know it, and the one-year anniversary, or excuse me, three, was just last week, I think. I love resourcefulness. By that I mean there's a lot of creativity in being resourceful. My feeling is if you're really rich, you damn well better be a good cook. You can buy anything you want. The one that impresses me is the cook who has very little and works magic with what they have. That's a cook. Most of the cuisines that we admire came from the impoverished sections of those countries, not from the wealthy. That's resourcefulness. So this tsunami was going on, and my mother lived here in Bankers Hill, and that's her, Anne. She worked for the opera. She's a dress designer and was a preeminent seamstress. She could make anything with her hands of the highest quality. And she was stuck at home in a wheelchair at that point, watching this tsunami unfold. As old people tend to do, they watch too much television. And I would come home at the end of each day, and she would give me an update on how horrific it was. And she would lament at how she didn't know what she could do. What can I do about this? And to me, I would just kind of talk her off the cliff and leave. But this kept persisting. And she said, can you buy me some yarn? Back to these haberdashery comments and themes here. And she said, I'd like to learn to knit. So I did, and then I bought her more yarn, and before you know it, there are these scarves starting to collect. She always had to have a project like I do. Before you know it, there's dozens of scarves, and I finally asked her, what are you doing? She said, I don't know. I just need to be busy. And then a week later, she said to me, can you send these scarves to Japan for me? She was knitting for these cold children in Japan. Didn't say anything. But in terms of, to me, the resourcefulness of someone who just found a way to do, with the tools she had and the skills she had, something of love, I thought it was really cool. And I think a really great example of resourcefulness and possibility and creativity and curiosity. She died right after that, right in front of me, part of the feast and famine and locust period, she died at a heart attack right in front of me. So then I never sent them to Japan. But I had to set up a memorial, I'm getting into too much detail, at the opera, who wanted to celebrate her. So I wore this one tonight, not because it's cold, but because she made it. And instead of sending it to Japan, I made a label, hired a really good design firm, and draped them around the back of each chair at the memorial. And as we spoke, and I told people to take them off and wrap Anne around their neck. So she actually created her own design for her funeral as a result. So I just love that story about being resourceful. Being the client you always wanted. And I realized, instead of searching out there, I decided maybe it's me. It's a lot of the theme of what we're talking about here. Our field is changing. We don't get paid what we used to do things. We have to invent what we do. I have a few thoughts that we really should never blame the client for not challenging us. If we're not challenged, it's our fault. If you're not challenged, don't blame your boss. He's trying to make a living too. You need to challenge yourself. And that's where we get to have fun. We get to point what we do in 360 degrees. And we can do it. It's just a matter of managing time. So in 2010, my life went to hell in a handbasket. And I ended up in my garage on my hands and knees. I started with a butter knife and a hand drill making stuff. I keep journals of ideas, which I highly recommend. And I had all this thought always about the globe as a canvas. What could I do with the globe as a place to map ideas? Rather than a flat canvas, a globe. And without any purpose or intent, I started to just make these things out of those objects that I collected. And that was fascinating too, because I didn't know why I was collecting these objects. You can relate to this. I've got stuff that I don't know why I have it. And then I would walk over and find something and bring it over to a design that I was working on. It would go, it belonged there. And I thought, whoa, something's going on back here that I'm not in control of. So I started to make globes, and before you know it, similarly to uppercase, we tend to theme things. We're good at that. We tend to programize things. We tend to figure out what it can be. We're very good at that. Hey, that's a skill we have, to stay on task. We're very purposeful. We know how to market. This became a show called The 100 Worlds Project, and I made these, but I also invited as many people to be involved as possible. The idea was not to become an artist, but to see what the artistry was in everybody around me. My mother kind of taught me that. We had a very nice show at the Jet Gallery in Little Italy. And this is the piece I wanted to focus on. I don't know if you can see it, but this was the premise of the project. Anybody asleep yet? Well, get out of here if you are. Come on. It's this one here. So the idea was, how many worlds can I connect to this idea? Kind of like branding. How many photographers? So there was 100 worlds, but what can I do with the internet and search and ideas? How do I invite them in? Photographers. Instead of me taking the pictures, I invited 50 different shooters who wanted to. I gave them a brief, and they took it away, and they shot it the way they wanted to. So I got their ideas back to me. Oh, that's that critique thing. I didn't like all the pictures, but I didn't get to say. It was their take on what I did, and I loved it. It was cool. Some of the things I initially was repulsed by, I've gotten to really like. Interesting how that happens. But the one, and then AIGA and other things, but the one I really liked was this thought here, the little quote that I wrote, which is, I want to do that. And that's the part of the student and the youngster, the little kid. I had this vision of somebody coming to the show because his dad was a welder that worked with me in Barrio, where my office is, and I was going to recognize Roberto Sanchez as a welder because he welded this piece, part of the process. And I saw his son coming, going up to the plaque and saying, look, Dad, you're an artist, not just a welder. Because we own artistry as if it's our fiefdom. It's not. And I think inviting others to see their artistry is part of our job. So this was my payoff. You can't read this, but this is Max Umberg. Tracy, are you here? Tracy used to work for me, and this was her son. I was away on travel, and I came back to my office, and on my desk, Max had been playing on my desk, killing time, making a mess, while Tracy was working, and this is his world. He had taken bond paper and sketched out his worlds, and he had about six of them. One was made of baseballs, but he had just seen what was in my office. He stapled it together, and he left it on my desk. So I included him in the show. He had his own room, which was the bathroom. But the one thing I want to say about that is each one of us, sometime in our life, have had someone that believed in us, right? You know who it is right now. It's your uncle, it's your teacher, your next door neighbor, somebody who said, you can do that. And that's really, we're kind of, at least in my time of life, I'm really excited to have the potential to do that. We have to kind of take a leap of faith, right? And we don't listen to the no. And when you don't listen to the no, it's kind of like playing. It's like dreaming. It's like being a little kid. Somebody, I think it was Corinna, said Superman pushing a baby. You know, it's, why not? But we are trained as we get older to start listening a lot more to the no. And I'm really, I get great buoyancy from people who have stayed on that track. And their one guy is Paolo Soleri. Paolo Soleri is an architect, and I'm going to play a little video here to close out. He's an architect from Italy, a very small town. He moved here to work with Frank Lloyd Wright. I don't remember what decade. Worked with Wright for a while, and he got fired. He was working at Taliesin West outside of Phoenix. And he went off on his own and went down and bought a plot of land in the middle of the desert of Phoenix, or excuse me, outside of Scottsdale, and started to work on his own vision of what he thought Arco Santi might be. He had this very vast vision. In fact, that's my son Ben in the back middle, who used to come to the Y conferences. We were there and got a chance to meet Paolo. He died last year. This is, you can't see too well, this is part of his sketch of a vision. This is part of what got built. I highly recommend you go visit. It's a day drive from here. And there's a piece in here I just want you to focus on by this critic, architectural critic named Paul Goldberger. He's the bald guy. But the words he says I find really, really very interesting about this idea of curiosity and innocence and staying on track. And with that, I'll say goodbye. Can you lower the lights?
He's a guy, a man of very few words, but yet he's very incisive, and he has quite a mind. He's quite an individual. That's pretty inspiring.
By the sun, I would like to try to go, to come to Arizona, the land of dream. So after 6 months or so, I landed in Ellis Island. I could go outside and sketch Manhattan from Ellis Island.
For all the sophistication of, that there is to Soleri, there's also a very beautiful kind of innocence to him, because he truly believes he's going to make this happen.
He was way out, years ahead. You know, he was in outer space, and we were on the trail here on Earth.
Like, here's somebody that's really creating this kind of vision and living it out.
Soleri, clearly, there's no place in his brain for the recognition that this is impossible and crazy and almost unachievable. Therefore, he's actually managing to do it. It's kind of amazing when you think about it, but innocence or denial of certain kinds of reality maybe is necessary for certain kinds of human accomplishment.
Maybe you measure the strength of a society by the amount of freedom the dreamers have to dream their dreams without ever producing a dream you can actually touch. Maybe, as the poet Robert Browning said, a man's reach should exceed his grasp, or what's a heaven for?
I am Paolo Soleri, native of Italy.